This is Gordon Moore. He co-founded Intel, but before that, he came up with the law. Not a classic like don't murder or no white shoes after Labor Day, but one that nevertheless changed the world. In 1965, he noticed that transistors, a component of microchips, had shrunk really fast since 1959. His law predicted that every 18 months, the number of transistors engineers could fit on a microchip would double. In 1975, he adjusted the doubling time to every 2 years. Still exponential growth, just a little chiller. Depending who you ask, Moore's law either proved true or was a self-fulfilling prophecy. The young semiconductor industry cranked out smaller and smaller transistors at roughly the rate Moore predicted, and computers got crazy good, crazy fast. The first planar transistor, from 1959, had a transistor count of 1. The chip in the iPhone 14 Pro has a transistor count of 16 billion. 16 billion. That's a lot to fit on one chip. I had one of my writers, Amy, see how many grains of rice she could fit on one chip, and she only got to 261 before she called the National Labor Relations Board. And with that skyrocketing transistor count came smaller, more powerful devices. The Apollo guidance computer, the one that allegedly got those actors to the moon, had the computational power of about 15,000 flops. But it was only about 0.25% of the NES's power. The Xbox had more than 6 times the power of the iPhone 4, and the Xbox 360 had more than 10 times the power of the Xbox. By comparison, advancement in just about every other industry looks like turtle racing. I mean, in that same time, McDonald's fries got worse. Bring back the animal fat! When he came up with his law, Moore saw his industry as an exception to the far more iconic Murphy's Law, which says that anything that can go wrong will, because in Chipville, things only go well and then better. But now, despite all those glorious years of exponential growth, Moore's law is dying. MOSFET transistors, now the single most manufactured human-made object in history, literally cannot get any smaller because physics. To understand why because physics, I gave Amy, a sociology major, a couple days to get up to speed on the cutting edge of semiconductor engineering and quantum mechanics. Then I stole her phone so she wouldn't call the NLRB again. Here's what she wrote. You probably know that your computer works in binary code, zeros and ones. Transistors basically are those zeros and ones. If a transistor is letting an electrical current through, one. If it's not, zero. The more transistors on a chip, the more complex the information your computer can process, and the quicker it can do it. This transistor is made up of a bunch of silicon atoms peacefully holding hands in 4 directions via their valence electrons. For spice, the silicon crystal over here has some phosphorus in it, which has a 5th valence electron running around loosey-goosey. Over here, there is no phosphorus, but there is some boron, which, with only 3 valence electrons, has created holes that the other electrons are running around trying to fill. Where these two areas meet, we've got the depletion layer. The bonus electrons from this side fill the holes from this one, creating a negatively charged area that repels any spare electrons floating around phosphorus town. That prevents the current passing through, so the computer reads zero. But if you apply just a little positive voltage here, you neutralize the depletion layer and electrons flow freely, aka one. That's how transistors work. But why can't they shrink anymore? Today there are transistors that are just 2 nanometers wide, the width of 10 silicon atoms. If you go much smaller, electrons will be able to just hop the depletion layer and flip zeros to ones at random thanks to a little move called quantum tunneling. See, at this tiniest scale, there's innate uncertainty as to where things are and how they're moving. You can't just look at a particle and say, it's there. You have a wave, and its matching probability function tells you it's most likely there or there, but it could also be there, but probably not there. It's not that intuitive, but if you've ever used a public transit system or a highway, you've dabbled in the quantum physics mindset. Google Maps tells you your trip will take 25 minutes with classical physics level certainty. But you know that between traffic, missed trains, and your personal need for speed, you're probably looking anywhere from 17 to 31. That's how things go at the quantum level. It's all probability. So let's look at an electron approaching the depletion layer with that mindset. When it hits the barrier, it creates this exponential decay curve and dies out inside, so the electron's gonna be here with no weirdness. But if we shrink the barrier small enough, that wave doesn't die in the barrier, and some probability survives to the other side, meaning we have to accept that, even though classical physics say he'll be over here, quantum physics says there's a non-zero chance that Mr. Electron will pop up over here and let the current through. that's quantum tunneling. And if it's not, take it up with Amy. Though I'm still on her phone, so she probably won't see your text. If a transistor gets too small, electrons can just quantum tunnel through the depletion layer and flip a 0 to 1 at random, screwing with all that very important math your computer is doing. You're opening the door for Murphy's Law. Anything that can go wrong, will. If you put a bajillion quantum tunneling prone transistors on a chip, you'll get a lot of quantum tunneling. Transistors this wee wouldn't make computers better, they'd mess them up. And so, subatomic Murphy's Law kills Moore's Law. It had a good run. So, what now? Do computers stop getting better? Sadly, no. Humans are innovation gluttons who'll just keep making computers better until we finally die by their hand. The end of Moore's Law just means that computers can't keep getting better in the exact same way that they have since they hit the scene. Instead, the dweebs have to figure out something new, like quantum computing. I asked Amy to whip up a quick explanation of that, so let's see what we got. Eat rocks, bonehead. Well, that's not very nice. What's also not very nice is grocery store coffee. It's just so mid. It's not terrible, but the beans are just boring and mediocre and monotonous, and it kind of just takes all the joy out of making coffee at home. So what happens to me, and I'm guessing you, is that I give up making coffee at home and revert to spending $6 or $7 on a latte, and you know what the financial experts say? If by latte, no can have home. So you're faced with only bad options. You either kill your finances by going to a coffee shop or drink boring grocery store coffee. Unless you use trade coffee. You see, they're a coffee subscription service with over 450 unique roasts that delivers fresh, sustainably sourced beans from the best roasters in the nation straight to your door. So that means, with very little effort, you have beans made by skilled independent roasters and grown by people working under ethical conditions. Really, they just make your morning cup of joe an experience rather than a chore. For example, the Nebula Roast from Oakland, California is awesome. Partially for its name, but also because its flavor perfectly satiates my sweet tooth in a way most roasts don't. So if you're looking to upgrade your morning routine, great news, because right now, Trade is offering you all a free bag of coffee with any subscription when you sign up by clicking the button on screen or by heading to drinktrade.com/HAI.